Please give Ken a warm welcome.
Thanks, Steve, and thank you, Matthew, and thank you, Michael. And it is a great thrill to be here. And I'm a social work kind of guy, and I see all those people back there, and I want to have a conversation with you folks. So I'm going to do something, and I hope you indulge me. I'm wondering, if you're back there, could you please come and sit up here? Because there's lots and lots of seats here and here. It would just be great to have us all together. And while you're doing that, I'll just talk a little bit. So I believe that an opportunity like this is a great privilege, because the way I see what we're doing today is we are working on building even more inclusive workplaces, even more inclusive work cultures. You folks are leaders in workplaces, and people spend most of their waking hours in the workplace. So you have an extraordinary, extraordinary opportunity to build cultures in which everybody, and in particular within this conversation, everybody across the spectrum of health is welcome, is part of the group, is respected, is never derided because of who they are or what their constitutional elements may be or what kinds of challenges they face. And I thank you very much for coming to join me. I'm sort of interested in work, and so having people together is a very nice thing, I think. And so I want to just talk a little bit about the context of this meeting. And in addition to thanking the folks who did those wonderful introductions, I want to talk a little bit about where this comes from in terms of development. I want to acknowledge my friend and colleague, Wendy Brennan, who is the executive director of the National Alliance on Mental Illness's New York City Metro chapter. Wendy is one of the people who has spearheaded a group that, in addition to Prudential, and I should say I represent Prudential at, is working very, very hard on the issue that we're talking about here today. So Wendy and also Wendy's group and also the Northeast Business Group on Health have brought together a whole bunch of workplaces and organizations. Also, Kevin Bolger is an important member of that collective. This is a group that's sponsored, in addition to the Northeast Business Group on Health and the National Alliance on Mental Illness, by the Kennedy Forum. So Patrick Kennedy is a great advocate for inclusion for people who have mental illnesses, across the spectrum of mental illnesses, behind this group as well, as is the American Psychological Association's Partnership for Workplace Health. And so all of these groups are working together to do a few things, to create awareness that there are many, many people who have behavioral health or mental health challenges, to create workplaces in which all of us are welcomed, to create easier access to resources, because you probably know that seeking help, seeking intervention, is often not an easy thing. It's very difficult often to get to see a psychiatrist. It's often very difficult to see a therapist. It's wonderful that you have the EAP as a first-line support, but beyond that, it can be very challenging. So this collective, the Working Well Initiative, is directed towards developing those kinds of cultural aspects within many, many workplaces. And so I'm happy to be representing that group as well. So let me start. I do want this to be a conversation. I was telling Kevin a few minutes ago, I can talk. I can go on and on and on, and you really don't want that, because you've got a lot to say that's really important. I don't have all the expertise. I have some knowledge, but when we share knowledge, when we share experience, we all gain the most that we possibly can. So that's what I'm going to ask from you, that you jump in at any time, and I'm going to echo one of the messages that's already been spoken, and that is that we are just pricking the surface when we have a conversation like this. We're just beginning to talk about an issue that is enormous and that you're going to have a series of conferences on, and that really we could have courses on, car courses on this. so Dr. Kurzman has been working on this for a very long time, the workplace and social work. This is a core issue, behavioral health. So if you leave here being frustrated and feeling like, I wish we had talked about this, or I wish we had talked about that, then we have done our work together, because this conversation needs to continue. And there's one other request I want to make, in addition to feeling like it's okay to be somewhat aggravated in that way, is to say the thing that is on the tip of your tongue, but you're not sure you should say it. You're not sure that it's going to be well received. You're not sure if it's politically correct. You're not even sure that the thought is well formed enough. Say those things. Say those things. Push yourself to say, I borrow that from a great mentor of mine, family therapist and scholar, Ken Hardy, who often says that at the beginning of a program. I find it extremely valuable. That's the place, that place of uncertainty, that place of, I'm not sure I should say these words. That's the most fertile ground for learning, in my experience. So work with me in that way. So let's get started, and let me ask you, how many people in this room have a family member, a coworker, a friend who has struggled with an addiction problem? Raise your hand. Okay. So if you didn't raise your hand, you probably just don't know about it, right? Because addiction touches almost every family. And addiction can take many, many different forms. In fact, there's a study that shows that about 16% of Americans have an active addiction at any given time. And I've actually seen other studies that push that to 60%. 60%. What are some things that people can be addicted to? Food? Shopping? Drinking? Alcohol? Gambling? Sex? Electronics? BlackBerry? Internet? Lots and lots and lots of things. So addiction is a pattern of compulsive behavior, and be substance abuse, that interferes with one or more of our important life spheres. And those can be our relationships, your physical health, it can be our workplace functioning. And you probably know that when addiction is identified as a performance issue, and that performance issue is challenged in the workplace, this is often where the person with the addiction will get help. Because they'll often lose almost everything. They'll be willing to sacrifice. The addiction will consume many other things, family relationships, finances, legal standing. But when it comes to work, sometimes that's the place where if the bottom line is drawn, you either take care of this performance issue, which means getting help, or you lose your job, the person goes into some kind of intervention. So what about depression? How many people here know a coworker, family member, friend who has a depression problem? Okay. Again, extremely prevalent. So about 1 in 10 individuals in the U.S. will have a depression problem at one time or another. What does depression look like? What are some of the symptoms? Sleeping, so very low energy, maybe oversleeping, sometimes not being able to rest. You kind of go either way. What else?
Isolation.
Not with being withdrawn, not wanting to be engaged with them. Lack of hygiene. A person might decline to the point where they don't take care of the bases. They don't bathe. They don't get themselves put together with their style of dress. What else? Illnesses. So it's a really important point. Depression is concurrent with most chronic illnesses. Often isn't identified. So cancer, diabetes, hypertension, all of these often have a concurrent depression. Also, addiction is often accompanied by depression, often not identified. What else?
Anger.
So irritability, anger, all kinds of negative moods. Sometimes it will be irritability. Sometimes it'll be just very down, very despairing, hopeless. The diagnostic criteria for a major depression is that a person is feeling this consistent negative mood for at least 2 weeks. never in that time able to experience a moment of joy. That's the diagnostic criteria of the American Psychiatric Association. And so depression is a very big issue in our workplaces. And so we'll talk about one more. What about PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder? Do you know anybody who is struggling with that? Yeah, okay. A little bit less. So post-traumatic stress disorder, I think, is greatly misunderstood, and it's tied on to certain populations more than others. Post-traumatic stress disorder is the normal human response to an event or a series of events or a situation in which one lives, where there is the feeling that one may be in mortal danger. So it can be, in fact, if you are in mortal danger, that you have been attacked or you're in a combat situation or you're close to a tornado and it may very well destroy you if you don't get out of the way. But it's the normal human response for many people. And so a person who suffered a crime has been victimized, domestic violence survivors, even a person who has lost their job will often experience post-trauma symptoms. What are some of the symptoms? What do you know about this? Flashbacks, okay, repetitive re-experiencing of whatever was traumatic. What else?
Paranoia.
Again?
Paranoia.
Kind of hypervigilance. Always, kind of making sure, because you never know, got to be very protective. Again, it's a normal response to being traumatized. One more.
Anxiety.
It's kind of free-flowing. Yeah, these are not the symptoms for everybody who might be diagnosed, but they're fairly prevalent. So here's what I hope to do today. These are sort of my goals. So when I go to do a talk like this, I bring an agenda. When I go to listen to a talk like this, I bring my own agenda. So yours may be a little different. But I'm hoping that we're gonna tie this into the workplace. Why is this a workplace concern? That'll help. What does it mean to lead a mentally healthy workplace? And why is performance management important? Why is performance management important? So let me just tell you a little story and ask you to comment on this. So you are all supervisors, right? You supervise people. Yes? Everybody? Great. So let's put it one degree. Let's say a colleague of yours. Let's not make this view. So you say to this supervisor says to the team member on a Monday morning, "Hey, how are you doing? How was the weekend?" By the way, a very good thing to do. Shouldn't have a personal connection with the people who are on your team. And this team member says, "It was a very difficult weekend. It was very difficult because, I've got a hypertensive problem. And so I monitor my blood pressure. And my blood pressure on Saturday morning was 260 over 140. And I called my doctor, and my doctor said, you gotta go to the hospital. Doctor met me at the hospital. I had a change in my medication. They monitored me for a while. And then I went home, and I'm actually doing fine now. I'm fine, my medication's been adjusted. I've been fine for the weekend, and I'm feeling fine this morning. So that's one story that the supervisor hears. The supervisor goes to another one of the team members and says, how was your weekend? And this person says, well, my weekend was really difficult. My moods were all over the place, up, down, up, down. I felt so badly at one point that I didn't know I'd be safe. And so I called my doctor, and my doctor said, you gotta go to the emergency room, you gotta go to the hospital. Went to the hospital, and my doctor met me there, talked for a while, adjusted my medication, and actually I'm feeling fine now. I'm really okay. I'm back to work. So the supervisor hears both these stories. How do you think they might be responding differently to these stories? What are they thinking about their team members? Are they thinking anything new or different about the first one to talk about hypertension? What do you think? How are they feeling toward this person? Work with me. Compassionate, they're concerned, they're glad he's doing better, right? What about the second one? Why do you think about this person? They're nervous. What else?
Not sure what to say.
Not used to that kind of a report. What else? What's another feeling that might be feeling?
For me, I feel on guard.
Feel on guard.
Like, be monitoring, see that person, something
different. Okay, so now we're worried. We're worried, is this person going to try to hurt themselves? Are we frightened?
Yes.
We're a little frightened. Some people aren't. Some people are. Okay, it might be depending on how used we are to this kind of experience. We do know lots of people have these kinds of experiences, right? We talked about the incidents. Okay, let me give you a word, which you've heard before, for the difference. And the word is stigma. That's stigma. Now, we're not saying that this is stigma writ large, big stigma. This is little stigma. This is everyday stigma. This is the stigma that says, maybe I shouldn't have said that, because my boss might feel like, you know, I'm not really up to taking on the next promotion. I have to watch this person, feel afraid for them. That's the way stigma works, writ small, writ every day. Do you agree?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. That's what we're up against when we talk about these kinds of conditions, these kinds of health conditions. Move forward. Just a little bit of a review here. Statistically speaking, 1 in 5 Americans, you can read through this. Most important are the last two. Treatment brings positive results for 80% of those who seek it. 33%